This is a production of PBS 39.
Main engine start, 4, 3, 2, 1. We have booster ignition and liftoff.
It's hydrogen powers the nation's space shuttles. Folks breathe easier thanks to its oxygen. And its helium fills half the world's MRIs. Now a global company, Air Products started out as a small Detroit operation under the leadership of Leonard Poole.
We inherited his enthusiasm. So his dream became our dream, and his concepts our concepts.
Back in 1940, his revolutionary idea of building on-site oxygen plants changed an entire industry.
Leonard had the focus, the drive, and you know that entrepreneurial instinct to make it happen.
Many of Leonard's early concepts and innovative ideas affect our everyday lives, in the computer you use, to the TV you watch, in the fuel that powers your car today, and in the vehicles of tomorrow.
Air Products was involved with hydrogen from the very beginning.
Learn how one man's vision turned this Lehigh Valley business into a Fortune 500 company.
I think Leonard Poole can best be described by three words, really. Entrepreneurship, integrity, and compassion.
The loss of his wife, Dorothy, inspired him to spearhead the formation of Lehigh Valley Hospital.
Leonard believed in himself. He believed in our hospital, his hospital, and he believed in this community.
Leonard and his wife's foundations continue to support the hospital and the arts.
I can't think personally of anyone that I have ever met who had such a big heart, a great conscience, and who was able to encourage others to do his work after he was gone.
Over the next half hour, meet the man who affected so many lives through his company and compassion in the legacy of Leonard Poole.
The Legacy of Leonard Poole is a co-production of PBS 39, Air Products, Lehigh Valley Hospital and Health Network, and the Dorothy Ryder Poole Healthcare Trust.
You've probably seen its tankers on the highway or passed by its headquarters in Trexlertown. But do you know what goes on through these doors at one of Lehigh Valley's largest employers? Eric Klingenberg, an Air Products chemist, prepares for the workday. He and his coworker Shafiq chemically adjust a polymer solution. His team performs hundreds of tests as they develop different products. Thanks to Eric and his team, you won't have to cram your books into your suitcase when you head on vacation. Instead, all you'll need is this sleek, high-tech e-book, which uses electronic paper you can read in the sun or dim light. While an e-book might not be a household item yet, Air Products already impacts our lives every day, from A to Z. Automobiles. Its hydrogen helps make cleaner gasoline to fuel our cars today and wants to power our cars of tomorrow with hydrogen fuel cells.
We all know that we have to reduce our dependence on oil. And as a leading supplier of hydrogen and with our technical skills and capabilities, we think we can play a role when it comes to things like hydrogen vehicles.
You also might be surprised to learn that the largest supplier of helium, Air Products. It fills everything from party balloons to blimps, but that's not all.
We keep over 50% of the world's MRI units cool.
If you've got a cell phone, it's likely one of Air Products' specialty gases went into making it.
It goes into your computers, your PDAs, flat panel TVs, Sony PlayStations. So there's a variety and growing use of our materials in the electronic area.
So how'd this company find its way into our TVs, cell phones, and cars? Decades ago, Leonard Poole founded Air Products with a revolutionary idea involving oxygen. His ideas still breathe life into the Lehigh Valley today. On a steamy summer afternoon, this group gathers for a picnic. Some take turns tossing horseshoes, while others listen to the band. About 300 Air Products retirees come together at Emmaus Community Park every year. People reminisce about the good old days and their grandkids, but peppered throughout conversations is Leonard Poole, the man who started this global company, which today has about $9 billion in sales.
He had a heartfelt instinct as to what is the right thing to do. He made people want to do their best.
He was one of the most compassionate people there was.
He always managed to go by in the morning and say, good morning, how are you this morning?
Many of these former employees started working for Leonard back in the 50s. He actually started the company in Detroit in 1940. But Leonard's story begins in Minneapolis. Born on November 5, 1906, he was one of seven children. Early on, the family moved around with stops in Montana and Pennsylvania. After World War I, his father's health deteriorated. He died when Leonard was just 19. That was the beginning of his early interest in healthcare.
Because of his father's early death, Leonard had to drop out of school as a teenager and start to work to support the family.
He picked up various jobs. He worked on cars, sold Pillsbury pancake flour, and later sold welding equipment. In 1929, while working in Detroit, he met the woman who would become his wife and a driving force behind his success, Dorothy Ryder. The two married on December 19, 1931. Leonard shared his dream of creating a successful industrial gas equipment company with his new bride.
He looked at how compressed oxygen was delivered to customers in cylinders that weighed five times the oxygen itself, and came up with the idea of building oxygen plants right next to the customer's facility and developed that on-site concept. Very revolutionary at the time.
Today, Frank Pavlis keeps up with business trends reading the Wall Street Journal. He met Leonard back in 1939 here at the University of Michigan. The young entrepreneur was searching for his first employee. Pavlis had just earned his master's degree with honors when Leonard offered him a job. Frank wasn't sure he wanted it, but Leonard's persuasiveness convinced him.
He thought a moment, then he stuck out his chin, which he did many times after that, and said, well, maybe you've decided not to work for me, but I've decided that you will.
At this point, there wasn't even a company. The future hinged on Pavlis' ability to design and build an oxygen plant. One small problem, he'd never even seen one.
Well, I swallowed three times and wondered what I was getting into.
After hosting successful oxygen plant demonstrations, Leonard decided to start Air Products. The company officially opened October 1st, 1940, with no capital and no business. Detroit's Wayne State Mortuary School became its first home. Leonard's brother, Walter, ran the school and offered him the space.
We inherited his enthusiasm. So his dream became our dream, and his concepts our concepts.
The company first filled an order to redesign an oxygen cutting torch. The work wasn't what Leonard had in mind, but it brought in revenue. On December 7, 1941, the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. The war would greatly increase the demand for oxygen, and Air Products met that need.
World War II really saved Air Products because that provided a tremendous amount of work.
By 1943, Air Products outgrew its Detroit location and moved to Chattanooga, Tennessee. In less than a year, the company grew from 70 employees to 280. But the end of World War II brought tough times because its government contracts ended. The company needed to move to a smaller, more affordable location in 1946.
We were able to buy the Donaldson Iron Works in Emmaus, which was an old foundry, and that was the new home of Air Products. And we were living from hand to mouth for the first 20 years. It was difficult.
To persevere, Leonard needed a strong workforce. One of his core beliefs, hire the best and the brightest.
He was a visionary, and he thought that if he recruited enough bright people and gave them their lead and guided them and made them stick to these high standards that he himself had, that Air Products could become a world leader.
He was a person who stayed consistent in his attitude toward life, which was always one of optimism and hope and belief, confidence, vision for the future.
If you didn't meet those standards, Leonard wouldn't do business with you. He called off one merger because he didn't like the actions of another company's president.
The man in charge was very heavy, and drank a little too much bourbon and smoked cigars. The next morning, Leonard said, "We're not going to do that." And I said, "Well, you know, the numbers are right. We're getting this for a good price." He said, "I would never put my company in the hands of an individual who lived and behaved like that."
Using his code of ethics as the guide, Leonard made some great hires, and he truly trusted his staff.
Leonard Poole did not believe in time clocks, and this really amazed me that we could go there and didn't have to punch a clock in, but he had enough faith in his employees that he didn't think their time clocks were really needed.
Ed Donnelly was one of those folks who didn't punch a time clock. He worked tirelessly for Air Products. He would succeed Leonard as president in 1966. He became chairman in 1978. Retired since 1986, Ed still stops in his Air Products office and catches up on paperwork. He was just 21 years old, fresh out of college, when he started working here.
He was inspirational, no question about that. Not only to me, but many others.
In 1952, Leonard hired another bright young man as a sales engineer, Dexter Baker. He would also become chairman of the board in 1986. Dexter retired in 1992. His focus today revolves around the community. He's passionate about helping the arts. His impact's felt on the campus of his alma mater, Lehigh University. On this night, he and his wife attend a performance at Baker Hall, named in his honor, in the Zollner Arts Center. He earned his MBA at Lehigh while working at Air Products. His thesis focused on the feasibility of an international division.
And he said, "All right, smart guy, how would you like to go to England and start Air Products in Europe?" Well, I was 29 years old, you know, and this was, and I said, "Well, you know, how much time do I have to decide?" And he said, "Well, would tomorrow be okay?"
Dexter spent 10 years in England forming the international division.
I think Leonard recognized that if the company was to grow, it had to go into new markets and new technologies and new business areas.
The entrepreneur is the core of the free enterprise system.
By 1957, net sales reached $34 million. Even though sales increased, there was a shortage of working capital. But that didn't stop Leonard.
He was unafraid to tackle almost anything, no matter how difficult, if he was enchanted with the prize, the result.
In 1958, Air Products shifted its operations to its current site in Trexlertown. In 1960, Leonard graced the cover of Business Week. By 1962, sales exceeded $100 million and was listed on the New York Stock Exchange. While most of his time was dedicated to Air Products' success, he did relax occasionally. One of his favorite pastimes, fishing. Today, Lee Holt casts his line hoping for a big one. Lee, Leonard, and others were part of a local fishing club in the 60s and early 70s. They spent many weekends relaxing here at this Poconos cabin.
He was a good spirit. There's one place where he could relax. And actually, some major decisions were made there on the front porch of that cabin.
Lee started working at Air Products as general counsel in 1957. Few people got to know Leonard better than him, and that fishing cabin played a big part.
At that time, there were no stores in that area. We had to bring all our food up from Allentown. And Leonard took charge. On one occasion, he brought up a microwave just to broil the bacon.
Leonard had other pastimes, like collecting antique cars. He also stepped up to the plate at company picnics. Leonard loved dogs, too. He brought this English bulldog back from London. It was one of two dogs he owned. Whether he was relaxing or working, he always cared deeply about his employees.
And they were writing the annual reports every year. The last sentence in his president's message was the importance of the people at Air Products. And he strongly believed that.
Current Air Products president John Jones also holds that belief. Charged with leading Air Products into the future, he understands its past and Leonard's vision.
He always believed that technology was a key part of the formula to this day. You know, if you look at our leadership positions and businesses, we really drive technology as a very, very strong part of what we're all about.
Air Products operates in more than 30 countries and employs over 20,000 people. Today, the company is the largest supplier of hydrogen to the petroleum refining industry. That hydrogen processes clean fuels. 75% of Air Products sales comes from gas and related equipment. Earlier, we said this company affects our lives from A to Z. We've jumped ahead to K, for keys. Keys and virtually anything else made of steel or other metals benefit from Air Products' oxygen and nitrogen. How about L, latex paint? Some Air Products chemicals are used to manufacture paint. M, Air Products plays a part in medicine too. And N is a big one. More than 90% of the world's liquefied natural gas is made with Air Products technology and equipment. The company also leads the way in designing hydrogen-powered fueling stations. Hydrogen has the potential to become a significant energy source in the U.S. Hydrogen-powered cars are making headlines, but the concept isn't new. In 1967, Leonard wanted to impress a potential client. So, in secrecy, a team worked on turning a 1967 El Camino pickup truck into a hydrogen-powered vehicle. And it worked. The success satisfied Leonard. Then he had the group replace the carburetor and sell the car back. Apparently, no one spoke of the six-month project for the next 34 years.
Leonard had the focus, the drive, and you know that entrepreneurial instinct to make it happen.
Leonard's desire to be the best in the industry fueled many research projects. Much of that early research and design set the foundation for Air Products today. Leonard expected a lot from his employees, but he also cared about their well-being and their families too.
Leonard would never turn his back on somebody that had a need or an illness or a financial crisis.
He always said what he really wanted to be was a doctor. And it was obvious his compassion for people. He would have made a wonderful doctor, but he made a great boss.
Back at the picnic, folks recall stories of Leonard's kindness.
He was one of the most compassionate people there was. If an employee or an employee's wife was seriously ill, or any member of the family, Leonard would jump in there and make special arrangements if they needed special treatment at the hospital.
I remember when my friend got sick back in the 60s with leukemia. He didn't waste any time. He got the specialist from Sloan Kettering to come down and see him.
Air Products employees felt Leonard's compassion, and so would others in our community. When his wife developed lung cancer, he learned firsthand how difficult it was to be away from home and care for a loved one. He didn't think it was fair that people had to travel to receive care from the nation's best doctors. After 26 years at the helm, he named Ed Donnelly his successor so he could focus on his wife. He stayed with Dorothy day and night at New York City's Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center.
And I assumed that he could not afford a hotel room, and I told my wife, Eva, the story about this nice gentleman who was sleeping in his wife's room. And she insisted that I bring him home for dinner.
The dinner sparked a friendship.
I'm sure people who worked for him saw him, you know, as a businessman interested in the projects and the bottom line, but he was truly a very sensitive, caring man.
Retired from practicing medicine, Larry spends much of his time working on a book. It's about his experiences with patients. He shares the Poole story.
Leonard talked about what an amazing woman she was, an accomplished pianist and painter who lived every day to the hilt and had, quote, the best laugh in the world.
Those who knew the couple knew how important Dorothy was to him.
They had a very close relationship. Leonard hardly needed motivation by others because he was self-motivating. But even with that framework in their relationship, she was a motivator.
Dorothy passed away in 1967. Leonard mourned, but he took action. The country's best doctors cared for his wife, and he believed others should receive the same treatment here in the Lehigh Valley. He set out to build a regionally superior hospital. Longtime Air Products employee John Bodie spends time on the links now that he's retired. But when Leonard needed him to be his project manager, John's focus turned to helping him fulfill his dream.
And he vowed that he would have medical services in Allentown equivalent to New York so that Joe off the street, who couldn't afford the medical, would have it medical services locally here in Allentown.
Leonard quietly donated $5 million of his own money to get things started, but more money was needed. John recalls a special telephone conversation.
Hello, David. Leonard, we need some money. I'm going to send my boys up to talk to you. It took me a long time to catch on. It was David Rockefeller that he was talking to.
These days, Dorothy Hoffner Folk volunteers at the gift shop at Lehigh Valley Hospital's 17th Street location. She helps folks find that special something to help brighten a loved one's day. As Leonard's longtime secretary, she remembers the building process.
I always used to say to him, building this hospital brick by brick yourself, and he really put every ounce of his energy and time into that.
The hospital opened in 1974 and became Lehigh Valley Hospital. Leonard encouraged his old friend, Dr. Larry Levitt, to be its first full-time neurologist. Just like at Air Products, Leonard looked for the best and the brightest in healthcare too. That tradition continues.
What makes us able to accomplish what we have over the last bunch of years, over our entire history, is the people who choose to work there.
President and CEO Dr. Elliot Sussman keeps up with staff. Getting feedback from doctors and nurses helps him stay in touch with day-to-day activities. Lehigh Valley Hospitals emerged as a leader in many areas over the last 30 years. U.S. News and World Report lists it as one of the top hospitals in the nation in eight categories: cancer care, digestive disorders, endocrinology, heart care and heart surgery, kidney disease, orthopedics, respiratory disorders, and urology. Bob Johnson and his son Trevor spend a lot of time together playing soccer thanks to Lehigh Valley Hospital. The Johnsons recently endured quite a scare. Bob suffered a cardiac arrest, his second heart attack in a year. Medevac touched down at Lehigh Valley Hospital. Emergency personnel wheeled him into the ER. The staff took action, but not just from his bedside. About a mile from the hospital's Cedar Crest site, an intensivist watches over critically ill patients like Bob. Doctors assessed Bob's status and decided he needed a cutting-edge device called the Arctic Sun. It cools the body's core temperature, which studies show can help prevent brain damage.
That was very important. That's the difference between being able to sit here and do this or not being able to sit here and do this.
Through Leonard's trust, the hospital purchased the Arctic Sun.
I'm glad he came here and I'm glad they did what they did for him. I think we would all have been lost without him.
The Johnsons might not have had access to this care if it weren't for Leonard's dream.
Leonard believed in himself. He believed in our hospital, his hospital, and he believed in this community.
Leonard died in 1975 at 69, but his legacy remains. The Dorothy Ryder Poole Healthcare Trust was established in his wife's honor. It supports Lehigh Valley Hospital. The nonprofit organization began with his $15 million estate, and more than 30 years later, it's grown to over $80 million. The Ryder Poole Foundation, established by Dorothy and Leonard in 1957, focuses on culture, art, human services, education, and community development. Executive director of both boards, Ed Meehan, often meets with his staff to discuss how to distribute funds. Their top priority is to carry out the Poole's ideals.
My sense is that they were a very strong team, that they really valued one another and they really looked to one another in a real partnership. They were husband and wife, but they were also real partners in terms of thinking about the work in the community.
Grants from the trust benefit many programs, treatments, and devices at Lehigh Valley Hospital, like the Arctic Sun.
It's not necessarily a household name, but I suspect many people are touched by the ongoing work and the sustaining work that has been provided by Lehigh Valley Hospital and others.
Dorothy's foundation opens doors for those who might not be exposed to the arts.
Music is very important to me. I love playing. It just makes me feel happy.
11-year-old Morgan Bush shares a love of music with her grandmother. She's learning the basics at this community music school in Allentown, which receives funding from the Ryder Poole. And Morgan may not have been here without the help of a scholarship from the foundation. Morgan might grow up to play in an orchestra and may accompany a performance of the Nutcracker someday. 17-year-old Matt Harvey dances as the wooden soldier in this classic. He excels in the Repertory Dance Theater's Talent Identification Program, or TIP, also funded in part by the Ryder Poole Foundation.
Which is a program for at-risk and disadvantaged youth in the Lehigh Valley. We go into the schools and we audition over 1,500 kids.
it kind of carries out into the real world. Like I used to always walk around with head down, now shoulders back, head up, you know, looking straight ahead.
Thanks to dance, Matt's future looks bright. But what's on the horizon for the Poole Foundation and Trust? Well, according to Leonard's will, the life of the trust runs out in 2025. Whatever's left over goes directly to Lehigh Valley Hospital.
We're going to have to come to grips with how we'll think through enabling families to have healthy babies, enabling mamas to have the very best opportunity for adequate and appropriate prenatal care, good early health care for children in the early years.
On occasion, Dr. Levitt pauses at this portrait of Leonard and takes a moment to ask him how he thinks the hospital's performing.
I think he would be pleased. I think he would not have imagined that it would have grown to this extent, but he would expect us to do more and to do better and never let up.
People say, well, so what's the dream? What do you want to be? We'd like to be the premier academic community hospital in the United States.
So how do you do that? Exposing young people to potential healthcare careers is a start. Leonida Castillo participates on a nurse job shadow. Listening to this tiny infant's heartbeat, she realizes why she wants to become a nurse.
I want to see what it's like as just to make my decision more affirmative. Make sure that's what I actually want to do in my life.
Area high school students learn early if a career in healthcare is for them. At Air Products, recent college graduates have opportunities most young hires don't get. Amy Tamayo and Ben Goldberg participate in the company's Career Development Program, or CDP. Each person gets a chance to explore different aspects of the company by performing three different year-long assignments in unrelated fields.
The Career Development Program is about choices and challenges. It's about motivated individuals who want to take lead on to their careers.
The CDP program is absolutely phenomenal for my career. It's given me exposure to really important decisions that need to be made at Air Products.
John Jones, like Amy and Ben, participated in the CDP back in 1972 when he first joined the company. In fact, 113 current Air Products executives took part in the program over the years. Today, John leads discussions about current company activities. He's also out in the field helping New Orleans employees as they try to recover from Hurricane Katrina.
The key is to provide, bring in the right people, give them the systems, the tools to allow them to thrive in that environment versus fear that environment.
Back at the Air Products Retirees Picnic, folks still share their Leonard stories.
I just consider him such a great man who really tried, I think, to help everybody.
I'll never forget him, I won't, you know. I was really devastated when it was like maybe my own father died.
Well, he was an asset to the community. He done a lot for Allentown. I mean, look at the hospital, and for Air Products. I think he was wonderful.
With each test, new technology emerges on Air Products campus. The door closes, but Air Products work continues. The work Leonard Poole began so many years ago. His legacy breathes life into the Lehigh Valley and beyond.
The Legacy of Leonard Poole is a co-production of PBS 39, Air Products, Lehigh Valley Hospital and Health Network, and the Dorothy Ryder Poole Healthcare Trust.